Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love. He led, forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll find life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
You all can be seated. Good morning, church family. How are we doing this morning? Good. Well, if we have not yet met, my name is Billy. I'm the associate pastor here. And just a few things to go over, and we will get right back to it. So we have a ladies' life group here at church, and they are collecting personal care kits for people in need in our community. And so they are going to be collecting those items. There are gallon freezer bags by the welcome tables, and those bags have lists of items in them. And so if you'd like to contribute to this ministry and be a part of this opportunity, you can look at those bags, look at the list of items in them, and then bring those things here to the church by December 12th. And then the last thing there is place the items you would like to contribute into the bag and return it to a labeled receptacle in the gathering space. Again, you have until December 12th to bring some of those things to help the people around our community in need. That leads into my next thing, and that's our life groups ministry. So we are getting ready to go into a new year, and really one of the lifebloods of Prairie Bible Church is our life groups ministry. This is our small groups ministry. And so if you are not yet in a small group and you're interested in being in one or in leading a small group, please reach out to either me or Pastor Craig. Those are our emails out there, and we would love to include you in that ministry. Another thing we have going on today is we have our youth life group gathering. What's different today is we are gathering at the Hughes household, okay? So our middle school and high school life groups, that's fourth grade all the way up through seniors, we are going to gather at that address today at 1 p.m. from 1 to 2:30. And if you don't get that address marked down in time, just find me and I will pass that along to you. Another thing we recently did here at PBC, obviously with moving to two services, That opens the door for more and more opportunities for people to serve on teams here. And one of the teams that we love to invite people to serve on is the worship team. And so on our website, on the PBC Ministry page, there is a worship serving interest form up. And so if you are interested in using your gift of worship to be a part of our PBC team, the first step is to go to our website and fill out the worship serving interest form. That is on the PBC Ministry page under worship, and fill out that form, and that will come directly into us. And then last thing, we have our all-church gathering coming up. So we don't want to just be a staff-led church. We want to be a congregation-led church. And one of the ways we try to keep our congregation informed is our all-church gatherings. Those happen once a quarter. And we have one of those coming up on December 5th at 11 a.m. And so everyone is invited to that. This is an opportunity to figure out and hear about what's going on here and to chime in and to give your opinion about different ministries we're doing here. And so our all-church gathering is coming up. Please mark your calendars for that. Well, that's all I got. We will get right back to worship, but first let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we don't take for granted the gift we get each week to come into your house here as the body of Christ, as the community of Christians, and to worship you and to lift up the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and to keep the main thing the main thing. I pray that as we sing and as we hear from Pastor Craig this morning, that you would bless our worship, that you would bless Pastor Craig's message, that you would remove all distractions for the time that we're here, and that you would especially, Lord, minister to those who need to hear this message today. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you'd like to stand and sing with us.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. It runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. My song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh God, now I need you. one defends my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name is, what a beautiful name is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You could have had heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Could not hold you, the veil torn before you. You silenced the bones of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What and powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
God, just thank you for the sun this morning and filling our hearts with your worship. I love hearing the voices out here, and I know that you do too. So I pray that you just be with us this morning and give us that energy. Just give us that fuel and drive for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
Amen. I'm going to invite the kids to come forward so we can bless them. And as they're coming up, I want to let you know about just a little reminder. If you are interested in being in the choir for the Christmas season, there's practice today. Where's John at? 3 o'clock today? Is that right? 3 o'clock today? If you're interested in being in the choir, we'd love to have you. All the kids up here? All right, congregation, extend a hand towards Hollywood too. She's coming. All right, come here. Come here, everybody. Oh, and by the way, I don't know if y'all knew this, but it's Merritt's birthday. She's 14.
No, 7.
Lord Jesus, thank you so much for these beautiful children. And I ask you to bless them and love them. Bless their teachers as they come together today to learn more about you. And I'm praying, Lord, that we can learn from them. As the scripture says that that we should look to the little children, and when we do, we'll see what it really means to believe. So bless them, love them. Bless us and love us as we come before you today to learn your word in our way too. We love you, Jesus, in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. You guys head right that way, okay? Apparently she's not really 14.
Back in the 90s, was anybody alive back in the 90s? Some of you weren't, I know, but most of you were. Back in the early 90s, there was a great film produced called A Few Good Men. Anybody remember that one? It's a great movie. It starred Tom Cruise and Jack Nicholson, right? And the premise of the story, if you recall, was that there was a Marine that died on the base at Guantanamo Bay, and Tom Cruise, as a lawyer, was sent down there just to tie up loose ends to make sure everything was okay. And he discovered, the deeper he got into it, right, that things weren't okay. And one of the most famous scenes in movie-making history is in this. And you probably know exactly what I'm talking about, don't you? Watch this.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask for a recess.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, then why did he have to be transferred? Colonel, Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object! And when it went bad, you cut counsel. These guys loose!
Your Honor,
you had Marcus inside a phony transfer!
Your Honor,
you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Captain!
You coerced the doctor!
Consider yourself in contempt!
Colonel Jessup! Did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Lisa just Peter Pants over there. Makes you nervous, doesn't it, Lisa? People start yelling, ugh. Now, Colonel Jessup is not the most likable character, right, in this. But you got to admit that what he said in that last line, you can't handle the truth, is the truth. Now, some of you don't want to admit it, but it is the human condition for us to oftentimes try to avoid the truth. What we really try to do, see, we'll try to convince ourselves that that we spend our life in pursuit of the truth, but when in reality what we do is we spend our life in pursuit of the things that will affirm our preconceived notions of the truth. Think about that. Because sometimes the truth moves us outside of our comfort zone. That's kind of what they were getting at in that scene there. Sometimes the truth moves us outside of our comfort zone, and it's just easier to seek out the things that affirm our preconceived notions rather than to seek out the things that are the truth. It just is. It's human condition. But it's very dangerous to do that. Because when we only seek out the things that affirm what we want to be the truth rather than the truth, we can be deceived. And instead of moving to the truth, we move away from the truth, which causes us to move away from God. So, this morning, by the way, for those of you who may be guests or visitors with us, we have all of 2021 been on a journey through the New Testament book of Acts. And today is the last Sunday of our journey through the book of Acts. We're going to be in Acts chapter 28. And what we're going to discover today, what I'd like to do in Acts chapter 28 as we kind of sum up our journey, is I want to point you to a couple of examples of how human beings sought out preconceived notions or things that affirmed their preconceived notions rather than the truth. One of them is just kind of an innocuous, not necessarily that important example, but the second one I will share with you has eternal consequences. And this is what I want you to glean, the lesson that I hope you'll glean from these stories today. Though it is the human condition to want to have our preconceived notions affirmed rather than to seek out the truth most of the time, we have the ability to choose otherwise. And if we left to our own devices, we wouldn't. But we have the ability to choose otherwise. And today, I'm going to show you what that choice is and where it begins. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to look in Acts chapter 28. And if you're using one of the Bibles that we provide here at church, that's on page 1114. And as you're doing that, I want to go all the way back to the beginning of the journey that we started back in January of 2021 and to kind of relay the foundation of what was laid for us all the way back then in the beginning of the book of Acts. In the beginning of the book of Acts, the resurrected Jesus, he's been crucified, dead, and buried, and he's rose from the dead, and he's been walking with the disciples, with the believers now for 40 days. And he's been giving them final instructions before he ascends into heaven. And what we find here at the very beginning of Acts is Jesus giving them one final instruction. And it was pretty simple. He said, stay where you are and wait. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4, he said, I want you to stay here in Jerusalem and I want you to wait for the promised gift of God. And that gift of God that he was wanting them to wait for was called the Holy Spirit. Very important, so hang on to that, okay? Put a little mark by that. He said, go back to Jerusalem, or stay in Jerusalem, and wait for the promised gift of God, which is the Holy Spirit. And then what happens is that on the day of Pentecost, as they have gathered there, dutifully waiting for what Jesus told them to do, God pours out the Holy Spirit on the believers, and the church is born. Now, this is very, very important to not only understanding where we're going to be going today as we conclude Acts chapter 28. What I just described to you is very, very important for you today. The believers, people who believed in Jesus, were told to go and wait for the gift of God, which was the Holy Spirit, right? And it was then that the church was born. And I'm not talking about a building being built, right? What is the church? Who is the church? You are the church. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you believe and you have received. All right, because those two things together are very important. If you believe and receive, you see, the believers weren't the church until they received the Holy Spirit. Because the church, what God wanted the church to be is to be a simple and authentic representation of Jesus to the world, right? Sound familiar? That's what Jesus is calling the church to be, to share the gospel message, to share Jesus with the world. And here's the problem that the church would have had they not received the gift. They would have went out and tried to do those things on their own. They would have, according to their own logic, according to what felt good to them, they would have went out and tried to be the church. And here's the problem with that. You ain't that smart. We think we are, but we are not. Oftentimes, what we perceive to be the truth is not the truth at all. In fact, sometimes what we perceive to be the truth actually leads us away from the truth. So it's only with the gift and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, that we get to where we were meant to go, or that we are empowered to do that which we were called to do. So the two have to go together. You have to believe and you have to receive. Those two must go together. That brings us up to Acts chapter 28, okay? I want to share with you this morning from Acts chapter 28 a couple of examples of people living into their humanity without the Holy Spirit. The first one, you remember last week when Pastor Billy was preaching, he told us the story about how the Apostle Paul and all of his shipmates were in a shipwreck and they ended up on the Isle of Malta, right? Everybody was saved because it had been prophesied that everybody would be saved, that nobody would be lost in this shipwreck, right? And so they get on, they're on this island of Malta, and of course they're wet and they're tired, so they decide to build a fire, which is logical. They want to dry out and they want to get warmed up. And so they're all gathering wood, and among those that were gathering wood was who? The Apostle Paul, right? And it says, now, we got it up there now? Go ahead and put that scripture up there. Okay. It says, starting at verse 3, Acts 28, verse 3, it says that as Paul was gathering this wood, a venomous snake jumps out of the fire and latches onto his hand, okay? And the natives of the island of Malta think, well, there you go. They think divine justice is taking place right before their very eyes, that Paul must be a murderer. And that he wasn't going to get out of justice because of a shipwreck. They're expecting him, because of the venom of the snake, they're expecting him to swell up and just die right there on the spot, right? But what does Paul do? Shakes it off. And they wait a moment, and nothing happens. So what do they do next? They then presume, because he's been bit by this venomous snake and nothing happens, they then presume that he is a god. Now, which is correct? Which one? Neither one of them is right. They had two preconceived notions because of what they had in front of them, and neither one of their notions of the truth was the truth. What is the truth? That Paul is a child of the King, called to be the church and to proclaim the church, the gospel of the church to the world. That's the truth. Now, that one is not as nearly as big a deal as this next one. So now to jump to the end of the chapter, to verse 25. Paul has finally got to Rome, right? He's been on this journey to try to get to Rome to present the gospel to Caesar for a very long time now. It's been years, and he's been trying to get to Rome. He's finally there, and he's still a prisoner, but he's free to preach the gospel to the people that will listen who are there. And it says that some people believed because he preached the gospel. But it also says that some chose not to believe. And to their disbelief, Paul says this. He says, the Holy Spirit was correct when he said to your fathers through the prophet Isaiah that some of you would have hearts that would not believe, that your ears and your eyes would be closed to the gospel. Therefore, I'm going to the Gentiles. Translation, listen to me now. You can't handle the truth! That's what he was saying. Really, that's exactly what he was saying there. You can't handle the truth, so I'm going to go to those who can. I'll go bring the gospel, the truth, to those who can receive it. Now, if you're like me, I hear things like that and I just think, what is those people's problem? You ever do that? You ever get kind of like spiritually arrogant? I get spiritually arrogant. Why can't they see the truth that's right in front of their eyes? You ever do that? And then I start kind of puffing up a little bit. You ever do that? Listen to me. Quite literally, there but for the grace of God go you and I. I'm going to prove it to you. In Ephesians 2, 8, 9, it says, we have been saved by grace through faith, and even this not of ourselves, lest any man should boast. So, translation? The only hope that any of us have to see and to understand the truth is the Holy Spirit. The Scripture tells us that it is only by the Holy Spirit that we can be wooed, that we are being wooed into relationship with God. That by ourselves, we aren't smart enough or intuitive enough to do that. But the Holy Spirit woos us into relationship with God. Woos us to the truth. Well, some of you are saying, well, then why doesn't everybody see it then, right? Ah, now this is important. Because though it is true that God is wooing all of us into relationship with God, God doesn't make you do it. He loves you too much. You see, there comes a point when you must submit to the truth. Remember, it's been a couple of weeks ago now, but I spent some time at an end of a message. I do this pretty regularly, actually, but when we were talking about what it means to have Jesus as Lord, as opposed to just believing in Jesus, you see, there's a big difference here. If you don't believe in Jesus as Lord, which means to submit to his authority, which means to want what he wants most of all, you've believed, but you haven't received. So in other words, you can't, until you have believed and received the gift, which is the Holy Spirit, right? You are unable to fulfill the mission and the vision that you have been called to, that which you say you believe in. You'll be left to try to fulfill it with your own sense of logic and your own sense of what feels good, which will lead you what? Away from the truth often rather than towards the truth. You must believe and receive. And it begins by submitting to Jesus as Lord. It is not a politically correct statement. In some ways, it goes against the American spirit to talk about submission and obedience. But that's what's required. If you expect, have you ever noticed there are a lot of churches out there today? And I'm not casting aspersions because, again, they're but for the grace of God, right? There are just lots of churches that aren't living out the mission of the gospel. They're dying. They're not making disciples. Why do you suppose that is? I can tell you, it's very easy to tell you why. It's because they believe, but they have chosen not to receive. They're trying to do this thing, live out this call to be Jesus without the power that is required to actually live into it. There's a lot of Christians, and this is where I'm going to go from preaching to meddling, because I may be talking about you. Have you wondered why God doesn't seem to use you to bring others to the gospel? It could be because you're believing, but you haven't received. You haven't submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Because if you're trying to do this thing on your own, it just doesn't work. I'm going to make this even more real for you. If you've tried to do life on your own, it just doesn't work. It doesn't. Again, I've got fingers pointing back at me, but if you've tried to do life on your own, you've made a mess of it, right? Now, when you submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, does that mean that everything then becomes unicorns and rainbows? No, because you still live in a fallen world and you're still a fallen being. But what happens when you submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ is that you then have taken the believing part and put it together with the receiving part, and now you have hope. You actually have the power and the authority to live victoriously even in the midst of the brokenness. Today, I say this every week, but I'm going to say it again because I never know who may be ready to hear it today. If just because you read your Bible, just because you've come to church today, just because your grandpa was a preacher, it's not good enough. If you have never made the conscious decision to receive Jesus as Lord, you should do it today. And this will be a defining moment, and you'll see. You won't be like all your troubles have flown away, but it will mean that you have the power and the authority and the hope to face them, because you don't face them alone. You face them with Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit, a power that will change the world and you. As the man's coming forward to lead us in our final song this morning, if you would like to pray that prayer of Lordship and salvation, right over there at that open door is where we meet to pray with people. You don't need me to pray that prayer. You can do it right here in your seats if that's what you want to do. But if you would like to pray that prayer with your pastor, it'd be my privilege to do that. There could be other things going on in your life today that you need a prayer for, and it would be my privilege to pray with you about those things too. I'll be right over there.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Behind your regrets and mistakes, come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Thank you, Pastor Craig, for reminding us that it is by grace through faith we have been saved, not of works, lest any of us should boast. And as he was speaking about that, I was reminded of what Paul said in Romans 9. He said he had sorrow and unceasing anguish, anguish and unceasing sorrow in his heart for his brothers, for the Israelites, for his brothers and sisters. And rather than being presumptuous and thinking that we'd somehow deserve or are entitled to Christ, may we look out to those who don't yet have him and have anguish in our hearts that they might also become followers of Jesus Christ as well. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we are so, so thankful that it is by grace, by unmerited favor, through faith, that we have been saved. That just like the Apostle Paul as we close Acts, we have no right. We don't deserve the salvation you've given us in Christ. And we just acknowledge that again this morning. We are so, so thankful for what you have done for us through Christ. And we continue to pray for ministry and evangelistic opportunities in our community as we leave here this morning, that you would bring us across people who need the gospel, who need Jesus. And in those moments, you would give us the testimony to them that Jesus is alive and look what he has done in our lives. We pray these things in his name. Amen. Have a great week. You are loved.
Sarah was
supposed
to do that earlier. She forgot.
But I've seen you part the waters where no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me. Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone. But I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love? But I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down.